Hey folks, and welcome to Drinking Alone with Friends, a podcast where three friends drink alone together. My name's Chris.
What up? It's Todd.
And I'm Obert. English edition this week.
We're going to English press our beers.
This is a little bit
talk about cask beers, which is, I think, basically English pressing.
That's very fair. That's very fair, yeah.
It's very different from French pressing. We actually, press like English people into our beer. It's kind of the whole theme of this.
Yeah, we really like to rub in that whole Revolutionary War win, that's how we remind them.
That putting them in our beer. It's basically like human tea.
English
like tea. Yeah. Summer's unofficially over. It's after Labor Day.
Oh yeah, that's right.
We're it's
sad.
Practically middle of September by the time you're listening to this. So I don't know. You guys have a good summer? Was it, on the untapped scale, was it like a 4.5 bottle cap summer or what?
It was too short. 3.75, too short.
3.75?
I mean, this summer was pretty rough. So I'm going to say, honestly, one of the worst summers ever. Maybe like one.
Quarter bottle cap?
Quarter bottle cap? Yeah, I don't know.
I guess you got to leave room under. It could be worse.
It could be worse.
This is my thing. This is why there's no 5-star rated beers. There could be better beer. There also could be worse beer.
Yeah. So. True. Chris had a pretty bad summer. Makes me feel a little guilty that I asked the question, but my summer was pretty good.
Over 5-star summer.
5-star. Literally couldn't think of anything to make it better.
It's just Over's voice dubbed over Chris's voice in the podcast edit. Chris, how was your summer? 5-star.
Oh man.
I give my summer four solid bottle caps. For
damn,
sure.
It's a pretty good summer.
It was good. No smoke, which is always good. We had a weather-wise 5 out of 5 in Montana.
Wow,
this is great
okay.
summer. I couldn't have asked for better. So
that's awesome.
I'll take that for sure.
I was like, so the beginning of the North Carolina always fools you. Like, March, April is like gorgeous, right? It's like 75, sunny. And then, you get rainy for, a month, whatever. But I was like, I'm going to sit outside, every day and, just enjoy being outside. And then it all of a sudden was, 95 for the rest of the summer. And I was like, well, this is stupid.
that was your March-April mentality, right?
Yeah,
it was
right.
Oh, I'm going to be outside all summer.
Yeah.
And
it was just like, nope, I'm huddled inside in the AC like a normal human being should be. So it was a pretty hot summer down here. Hot boy summer, I think we...
Right, we did coin it. But now it's on to fall.
Yeah, yeah.
We've turned the air conditioners off, some of us.
Yeah.
We've started baking our apple pies. So we thought, what better way to celebrate this transition to fall?
This nice, cool weather.
Yeah. There's that crisp in the morning air sometimes.
Right, yeah.
So we're going to bring you some seltzers, specifically weird seltzers this week.
Yeah, well, at least mine. I know mine is a little bizarre. So
mine's pretty funky.
I think of this less as the end of summer podcast, and this is like a episode 250 was a cautionary tale where we don't want these seltzers to end up on episode 550.
Right.
True.
Right.
Yeah.
Who wants
to
drink first?
I know, Todd. You had to go to the fourth string fridge. To get this seltzer.
This is true. I had to go very far. I am kind of thirsty. I'm happy to go first after this venture. But yeah, I had to venture outside to... You know how we all have shed fridges, right? Like we have a fridge in our shed that's there specifically for when you use the pool. Well, that's where this seltzer was. So I had to go venture out there to get it. But we all know this. This is a common problem that all people have, not just me.
Right.
Yeah. And when you're reviewing beers, you're like, this is a great beer. I don't know if it's good enough for an inside, but it's like, this is a shed fridge beer. We all know what that means.
Yeah,
right?
For sure.
Right.
There are shed fridges. There are shed fridge beers that we all just know. It's instinct at this point. But I will say that my unique seltzer is actually a gift from you, Obert, and you gifted it to me.
Okay. Well, I don't even remember what it was. So why don't you tell me?
Okay. So this is a seltzer from New Hokkaido?
Hokkaido. Okay.
Hokkaido.
Yeah, yeah. I like these guys. Yeah.
This is called Yuzu Onu, Ona, and it's a craft seltzer. And it says, this yokai hides in fragrant yuzu orchards and lurking from shadow to shadow, slips away with your heart. It's a yuzu ginger hard seltzer. It's 5% ABV. I don't know much about this brewery, so I'm going to let you tell people about this brewery, but it says they're from Bozeman, Montana, and it's 190 calories.
Hold the can up. Okay.
Are you drinking the same seltzer?
Yep.
Nice. You want to drink it together then?
Yeah, why not? Screw it. Yeah, let me grab mine.
I don't think Chris remembered that that's where he got the seltzer from. That's funny.
Oh, this is great. Do you not have this seltzer too? Can we all three drink it?
I don't think I think I drank mine already. Maybe I have a backup. I can go check. I'll check real quick, see if I have one.
I'm lucky, like you said yuzu, because I didn't read the can. I just knew yuzu, and I was like, wait a minute.
Yeah, Obert gave it to us like 6 months ago, I think. A while ago.
Was it that long? I don't think it was that long.
I feel like it has been a while, but
maybe time flies, man.
It really does. So yeah,
like just yesterday we were drinking seltzers in the summer.
Oh man.
Well,
anyways, I guess a double review.
Yeah, it's a cool looking can for the listeners. It's got some like green like alien lady.
Yeah, I think I don't know if it's on the can or on Untappd, but it's like I think it's some kind of a Japanese mythical figure, like a trickster god type thing.
Japanese penis figure with a lemon hat on.
Mm. Interesting.
So yeah. I guess I should tell you about New Hokkaido because they're affiliated with, I think they're like a side project from the head brewer of Mountains Walking, basically. And it's their Japanese inspired, like, I don't know if you call it a ghost brewery or like a contract brewery or whatever you would call it. But like, I don't think you can go and visit New Hokkaido because it's just, they brew it out of Mountains Walking. But it's all Japanese-inspired stuff, so they do a lot of rice lagers, like Japanese styles.
A Phantom Brewery everywhere and nowhere.
Okay, well there you go. And from my understanding, Hokkaido is basically the Montana of Japan. There's mountains, it's snowy, there's like really good skiing there. It's less populated. It's northern Japan. If I ever go to Japan, like I think Hokkaido is the province or state or whatever that I want to go visit because it sounds like my kind of Japan, you know?
It does. I'm excited to try it.
Yeah, this will be interesting.
I will say that they do have an address and it's 800 East Avocado Street, Bozeman, Montana. So you could visit them, whether or not there's a tap room there.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know how a Phantom Brewery has an address, but that is their address.
Because they're everywhere and nowhere, I guess. Yeah.
All right, let's crack these things open, Chris. Let's do it.
It's beer Seltzer. 30, and I'm thirsty. I've been working like a dog all week long, so maybe something cold won't hurt me. Cause it's Seltzer. Beer 30, and it's time to party.
Yeah, baby.
In the fall. Okay.
Gets me every time.
So it poured really clear. Slight haze.
Yeah,
but,
slight haze. Like lemonade-y.
You know, you actually might be able to blind a T-Rex with this because it's just lights up like a light bulb.
Let's see if mine does the same. Let's find out. This is what the listeners tune in for. Double T-Rex action. Oh, yeah.
Well, we also have different shaped glasses, so it's good to test. And,
that's true. It's true.
Yeah.
But it's the same. Yeah.
On the nose, it smells like lemon to me.
Yeah, I get a decent amount of lemon as well. Maybe a hint of ginger, but like pretty strong on the lemon flavors.
It does smell a little like ginger too. Very, very lemony. I don't know what a yuzu is. This is not a fruit that I'm familiar with.
I mean, we all agreed, Todd, that you are the fruit spurt.
Yeah, but not fruit. You missed the end part of that. Fruit expert on all fruits but yuzu.
Oh, okay. Well, yuzu.com is a next generation reading and note taking e-reader. So that's, don't go there. Don't click on the first link that when you type in yuzu into Google. Oh, it's basically a lemon.
That makes
sense. Japanese lemon?
Yeah, we'll go with that.
All right. I mean, that makes sense. It smells like it's going to be good. It smells like it's actually going to have a little bit of like a funky flavor to it. So maybe more like a ginger beer style flavor.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I could see that.
But it is an interesting flavor mix. I mean, there's a Japanese lemon, and then I always think of ginger. The only time I ever have ginger really is with sushi. So makes a lot of sense. But yeah, I'm thirsty. Let's drink this thing, Chris.
Yeah, let's do it. Oh, how nice it is to drink with a friend.
Cheers.
Cheers. And I'm drinking, well, you know that you're my friend, and I'll say, I think I'll have myself a beer. Seltzer. All right, I'm just going to say right off the bat, way more ginger, way less lemon-y flavor than I was thinking. Not a lot of sweetness. It's pretty tart. Definitely has I don't know. I was like, you know, you drink seltzers to get like I feel like refreshed. I don't know if I feel refreshed necessarily drinking this particular seltzer. It's not bad by any means. It's just not what I was expecting at all from the smell and from hearing what a yuzu was. But anyways, Ted, I'll let you take it away.
This is weird. I actually disagree with your take. I think it's very refreshing, and I get a lot of lemon. I don't get a lot of ginger at all.
Interesting.
Like almost no ginger, but I do find it very tart.
Yeah.
You know, it's not overly sweet. But I find it like this is like a light lemonade flavor to me.
I'd say it's like too tart for, I don't know. I guess lemonade is tart unless you put like sugar and stuff in it. But like, I feel like this is like a tart.
Yeah, lemonade without all the sugar.
It's like a tartar lemonade. The more I drink it, I do get a bit more of a balance and I do get a lot more of the lemon on like the back end more so. Yeah, I mean, I mean, I like it. It's different. But yeah, that's weird that, I don't know. Maybe I have to sit out in the hot sun and drink another one of these to see if it is.
Or gonna, drink or. It in 52 degree weather like I am.
Hold on. I think I have to wait a little bit longer for me to hit that. it'll be 56 tonight. So if I stay up till, I don't know, 3 a.m., then it'll be 56. So I'll be close.
Do it for the pod.
I'll save a little bit until 3 a.m. But it's good. I think I was expecting something different. Actually, I don't know what I was expecting because I didn't know what a yuzu was either. So, but it is good. It is good. It's something different. But yeah, interesting one. It does say it's a haunting flavor on the can too.
Well, I think you're picking up on the reasons why I sent you this can because I've had this one. I kind of agree with both of your, even though you are kind of on opposite ends of the spectrum. I thought it was also a unique, like something you hadn't had before. So it's like, I gotta send this to the guys, see what they think of it.
Yeah. No, it's good. I like it.
I do like it. And I should point out that I prefer my lemonade to be super tart and sour more so than sweet. So this kind of goes right up my alley when it comes to that.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think I'm more of like a, I won't necessarily say it's like a full blown sweet lemonade, but like, I don't know. I guess I don't really drink a lot of lemon. I don't drink a lot of lemonade. I'm a sweet tea guy, you know? but like, you know, some sweetness is good in my lemonade. So, but I mean, it is good. And my palate like adjusts to it the more I drink it. So, it's not as overpowering as when I first took a few sips. So, but it's good. It is good. Untapped scale. Let me take a sip.
I think for my personal rating that I would give it a 4.25. I like it a lot. In fact, I think Obert should send me some more.
Maybe you can get some if it's from Mountains Walking, because I know you can get that.
That's true.
You might be able to find it locally. I don't know.
I think I'm going to be a little bit, you know, as the hardest rater on the pod, notoriously, I think I'm going to be a little bit behind. I think I'm going to give it a 3.75. It's good, and it's interesting, but I think there's some improvements that could have been made for my personal palate, which is what everybody should go for.
If Chris likes it, therefore it's the best. It's really.
Yeah, really. That should be the standard you go by. I just blew that pee just blew up on my microphone. I've never had that happen before.
I will say that I looked up the address for Mountains Walking Brewery because I was curious to know if they were in the same building. I'm here to inform you that Mountains Walking address is 422 Plum Avenue in Bozeman, Montana.
Oh, so, okay.
And this one is 800 East Avocado Street. Now, I looked at the map just to kind of verify here. Now, I will say that right where Mountains Walking is, Plum Avenue and East Avocado Street meet each other. And so it's almost like one has an address on one street and one has an address on the other street. But yeah, so that's, I believe you're probably right that they're probably in the same building, but their addresses
are different. Yeah, it's funny though, that the way they did it like that. Yeah, it's a fun little Easter egg on the can.
And if you type in 800 East Avocado Street, it comes up in the middle of the intersection.
I just did that too. Yeah. So yeah, I think it's the only avocado street in Montana, though. That's not a street you hear very often around here. But Bozeman's affectionately nicknamed Bozangeles for a reason, you know. So untapped only 62 check-ins.
Jeez. Okay.
Oh boy.
Yeah. One of which is me.
Well, this changes everything.
I've got my guess typed into chat.
Hang on. Maybe I should type mine in.
You're all set? Okay, I'm going to have you hit enter on the count of three.
Hang on. I'm not ready. All right, I'm ready.
All right. 1, 2, 3.
What
did you guys guess?
We're close. Oh, man.
So I guessed a 3.72.
And I guessed a 3.78.
Okay. Ooh, so this is going to be a close one.
Right in the middle. 3.75.
Tied.
I mean, you guys are pretty close, but Tud is closer.
Damn it.
3.69.
Oh, ooh, man.
It was really right. You know what? It really is on both of us for not guessing that.
We should have just went with it.
Damn it. Well, unfortunately, Price is Right rules, we both went over. So,
yeah, so wide open for me. Sounds good to me.
Wide open for over.
Quarter bottle cap, Bob. Sorry, Drew.
Sorry, you Drew. Lose a whole point.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't go too low, or else you lose a point. But then you'll win a point?
Oh, wait, I guess it's...
What's this?
Our own take on Price is Right rules. Okay, well, I have a seltzer. I'll just say, I saw this seltzer in the store and immediately thought of you guys. I knew I had to get it. So I think it's... Just based on the can alone, I think you'll enjoy this one.
You know, you're
so
kind of...
I'll go grab it.
Kind of a loser for not having the same seltzer as Chris and I, though. I mean...
True.
It's almost like you need an Obert to send you a can of this. It's really on yourself, ultimately, at the end of the day, is what I'm saying. I also enjoy the fact that I can talk and Obert can hear me, but he cannot respond.
He can't defend himself.
It's fantastic.
He can put all this in post, though.
But not his, though. Not his response, though.
I'm going to say this. I couldn't... If we did do a triple review, I would be excluded, though, because I'd already checked it in. So,
ooh, that's true.
That's you know,
no points.
Right. But yeah, anyway, like I said, I saw this can, thought of you guys. This is a fun one. It's got the Moose Juice Hard Seltzer.
Nice.
From Obert, Creekside.
I'm concerned about you drinking this beer or this seltzer. Are you
sure? What
do you
think the juice is?
Oh, yeah. Probably not the juice that you want to drink from a moose.
Which is the moose drool, right? We all know that's
no.
A good one.
Moose drool is good. I don't think moose jizz. I don't think you want to drink. And
yeah, it says made with real fruit pulp happens. Okay, interesting.
Oh boy,
malt beverage with passion fruit, blood orange, and pink guava.
Interesting.
So, like I said, I knew it was going to be a funky one. I asked you guys if you had any funky seltzers, and surprise, surprise, you both thought of the same one.
Well, it was by far the weirdest seltzer I had.
Same, and it's been sitting by my fridge, and I could not remember where I got it from. So I was like, "Well, hey, I got a weird seltzer."
And it was in my.
That would have been funny, though.
We're lucky that like I did not drink this while floating in a pool this summer.
Yeah, it was deep in the recesses of the shed fridge, I guess. You guys both poured yours into a glass. I don't know. I feel like seltzers are made to be drank from a can, especially because I feel like they lose a lot of the carbonation when you pour them out.
Yeah, I think normally I would have drank it out of the can, but how are we going to know if we're going to survive a T-Rex attack?
That's a good point. So I think I'll do an experiment. I'm going to pour half.
That's fair.
And I can tell you which tastes better.
You do you, boo.
Okay. All right. Let's crack the sucker open. Oh, this is weird. Not the color I was expecting.
Obert, I have
a
more
little
concern.
Concerned with this juice.
Obert, I reiterate my concern from before.
This looks like cloudy moose piss, basically.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah, this is a moose with a bladder infection, I think. That's what's going on here. Some kind of kidney disease, perhaps.
This moose is not a healthy moose.
It smells like flavor, so that's good. You know, sometimes seltzers don't smell like flavor. This smells like flavor.
What's the biggest flavor you're getting?
Well, this is made with passion fruit, blood orange, and pink guava. None of those. I don't know, just generic fruit, I guess. But it's a mild smell, like maybe like pear. Yeah, we'll go with pear. I feel like those aren't necessarily the smelliest fruits to begin with, but I don't know. T-Rex test.
Oh,
again,
God.
Lit up like a high beam.
I think you actually might blind the T-Rex, so you might be able to escape.
Might be able to escape, yeah. But okay, we'll see. You know, it actually smells a little bit like cotton candy. That's, I think, one of the flavors I'm picking up. Pink cotton candy, because I think they smell different. Okay.
All right.
Cheers.
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 I like beer. Seltzer. It makes me a jolly good fellow. I like
seltzer.
It helps me unwind, and sometimes it makes me feel mellow.
I believe that we can actually take Kiwi's voice from when she sang it and dub it over too. Have her be like his background singer.
Yeah. I think we have a Jenna version too. With this,
oh, we have everything.
Where she, yeah. So right away, I got to say, on the Seltzer scale, where zero is water and 100 is soda, it's too close to the zero end of the spectrum.
Okay.
There's not a ton of flavor in here, which is surprising considering it wasn't clear.
Yeah, that is kind of strange.
Yeah, it's very bland. Yeah. I think my theory is that a lot of seltzers like Polar or White Claw use natural flavors, but they're like the concentrated flavors that, you know, that are in there. And I think these guys are just relying on the fruit instead of adding in like the flavor extract, like the essential oil or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, I also forgot to mention that Creekside is out of Haley, Idaho. Shout out to Idaho for the moose juice. I don't know.
I didn't know Idaho had moose.
I mean, it's basically just more Montana.
But there's potatoes there, though.
Yeah, but I think Haley's more in the Panhandle part, which is a lot more of like the Montana part.
Okay.
And the south part, the big rectangle part, is more where the potatoes are.
That's potato land.
I think so. I'm not sure, but that's my understanding. I'm going to try it from the can and see if that improves things or ups the bubble factor at least.
Oh, what is the malted liquor? What gets you drunker quicker? What comes in bottles or in cans?
Seltzer.
Can't get enough of it. Seltzer. It's how we really love it. Seltzer. Makes me think I'm a man.
I actually got less flavor in the can.
Interesting.
I guess it makes sense because you can't smell it as much, right? It is kind of both flat though in the can and in the glass. Moose juice, you're not winning me over so far. Yep, a little better in the glass. I think this is a solid, and by solid I mean weak, 2.75. I expect more. You know, there's just not a lot going on in here. It's too watery, not enough flavor. Give me some more juiced up mousses in the salt. And like they're adding one mousse per like mash cycle. They need to have like 0.25 mousses per can.
So remind me of the seltzery, because there's a lot of moose juices on tap.
Really?
Yes.
Creekside out of Haley, Idaho.
Well, it does not exist on Untapped.
Okay, automatic point for me.
Creekside Hard Seltzer Company out of Haley, Idaho it's a subsidiary of Sawtooth Brewery, so another phantom brewery.
Okay.
And when looking it up, they have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 seltzers on Untapped, none of which are moose juice.
Do any of them have more than like 15 check-ins?
There's one called Pog, which has more than 15 check-ins, or has enough to have a rating. It has 10 check-ins.
Okay. Okay.
It's a really well-known seltzer, yeah. I guess.
Well, I said I saw this for the first time, so maybe it's a new, maybe they're branching out. It's possible. This is kind of an unprecedented situation here, fellas.
Never had it done before. I'm gonna look at Sawtooth.
Know what to do.
So I'm gonna look for Sawtooth and see if they have moose.
Maybe
juice.
They have it.
There you go. That's a good idea.
And maybe it just got mixed up. So they do have moose. It's J-O-O-S-E, right?
No. But is it a hard seltzer?
Or is it?
If it is, we'll count it.
Moose juice. It's just spelled juice then?
Yeah.
So they have it labeled on Untappd. There is a moose juice from Sawtooth, but that's out of Minnesota. Hang on.
Yeah, I don't know. Have we ever been in this situation before where we've had a untapped beer?
I think so, but generally, well, no. Actually, I don't know if we. I know we've had ones that haven't had ratings.
Yeah, we have had that. Right.
That haven't had averages. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Or like obviously like something that we went into it being like, yeah, this isn't gonna be on Untappd. You know, like. Right. Yeah. I don't know. We're in uncharted territories. 255 episodes in. Who knows?
We never thought we'd be there. This is like, what is our clickbait title for this podcast? 255 episodes in, and this unexpected thing that's never happened before.
I can't believe that this happened.
Like, podcast first.
Well, I think you don't get any points. I think you can't play the game.
Do I lose a tally? I don't know.
I don't think you lose a tally, but you have no chance of gaining a tally on this one.
Okay. You know, it's on me for not cheating and looking up on Untappd first. I really should have checked to see if it was there.
It's really on you at the end of the day.
I know. I should have been in the grocery store and asked a stranger to go to untappd.com on their phone and type in moose juice.
Correct.
See what popped up.
Well, I mean, I don't know if you want to drink something else and attempt to win a point, or you can concede.
Yeah, you know, if Todd was like 0.15 off, maybe I'd be reaching for the fridge, but...
Right.
I have moose juice to drink, so...
Lucky you.
I have a whole six-pack of them. I'm hoping that they get better as I drink more of them.
They age well.
Yeah. It is... I pour the rest in the glass, and it is still that same color. It's not like all the color was at the top of the can or anything, but...
Not the most appetizing...
Definitely a enjoy from the can type of a seltzer, I think. Not the most appetizing looking, but I hate to be the first one to rate it and give it less than a three.
add it to Untappd. Yeah, there you go.
All right, listeners. So we're bringing back a fan favorite and a podcast favorite. We're going to do a little fast money. But this time, you look at me, listeners, with the eyes. I am Steve Harvey now.
Oh, when did you grow such a nice mustache, Todd? Is that new?
It's been here forever.
Just hiding underneath the bad mustache. Exactly. He peels the mustache back. It's a better mustache.
Slowly replaces it.
So, who is going to go first in Fast Money?
I think, Chris, you
I'll go first. Okay, Ober wants to anchor. That works. That makes sense.
Yeah, I'm gonna walk away. Just text me when I come back.
Yeah, and this is the last combination, we talked about it, and we've never gotten even close to 200 points. So, all right, Steve, I'm ready whenever you are.
Yeah, so 2 minutes on the clock.
2 minutes, no, it's like 30 seconds.
Oh, it's 30 seconds? Well, we're going to start with 35 seconds starting now. Name an occupation a bad driver should avoid.
Taxi driver.
Name something specific that people make reservations for.
Dinner.
Name something that a woman never forgets about her fiancé's marriage proposal.
Location.
Name something that burglars check to see if a family is out of town.
Cars in the driveway.
Name something to do, or name something people do to corn.
Chuck it.
All right.
I feel like I did better this time around than I did previous fast monies.
So... To review,
I probably should have said eat for corn. Okay.
So,
don't tell me. Just tell me my score. Don't tell me the answers. Yeah.
So you got name of I can't tell. So I can't tell you. I just have to tell you what your score is.
You can tell me if I like. You can say like you got X amount. Like you said this, and you got X amount.
Gotcha. So name an occupation a bad driver should avoid, and you said backseat driving.
I said taxi driver.
You said backseat.
Definitely said taxi driver.
Well, if you said taxi driver, then this is different. Then you got... I'm going to let the records...
Yeah, play it back. Over in post. Let me know.
Name an occupation a bad driver should avoid.
Taxi driver.
But a taxi driver is 21 points.
Backseat, I assume, is zero.
Backseat is zero.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, I definitely said taxi. Play it back. Over, I need you to loop my answer back over.
Name something specific that people make reservations for. You said dinner.
Mm-hmm.
Number one answer, dinner. 35 points.
Let's go. Hell yeah. I'm already a quarter way there. Lock it in.
Name something that a woman never forgets about her fiancé's marriage proposal.
Mm-hmm.
You said the place / location.
Yep.
And that is number two with 31 right. points.
I'll take that. Oh, yeah, we're doing great.
Name something that burglars check to see if a family is out of town. You said cars in the driveway. And that's number three with 21 points.
Oh, hell yeah. I'm cooking.
And then name something people do to corn. And you said shuck.
Yeah.
Shuck is not on the list.
How is shuck not on the list? What, people don't shuck corn anymore? Back in my day, we had to shuck our own corn.
Nope. So in total.
Bullshit. Bullshit corn haters over here. I'm going to text over.
You have 108.
Hell yeah. Okay, over halfway. And Chuck should be there.
All right, I'm back.
Welcome back to the game, Obert. Fast Money, Tut Edition. Chris, after round one, ended with 108 points.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. It's pretty good. You were to go over your answers and all that, obviously.
Yeah.
We already did that.
We already did that part. Yep.
Okay. I was wondering. I'm like, oh, it got a long time.
We had some technical difficulties. We may have put a few Easter eggs for you to take care of in post.
Oh, fun. I love that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but Chris gets to listen to this part, right?
Yeah, he gets
to listen if he wants to.
Okay.
All right.
So I only need 92 points.
Only
92 points.
I got this. Easily. I'm just going to find the one where somebody, 92 people answered the same thing and Chris couldn't figure it out. So.
So with that, let's begin Fast Money. Name an occupation a bad driver should avoid.
Taxi driver.
Eh.
Delivery driver.
Name something specific that people make reservations for.
Dinner.
Eh.
The movies.
Name something that a woman never forgets about her fiancé's marriage proposal.
Where it was.
Eh.
The ring.
Name something that burglars check to see if a family is out of town.
The lights are on.
And name something people do to corn.
Shuck it.
No, you gotta eh him.
Eh.
Oh, they eat it.
Okay.
I don't know how I feel about this. It's a lot. It's hard going second.
Four of our answers are the same.
A lot of ants.
So just to jump ahead here, because the listeners have listened to this point, I was very confused by the last one because while you gave the same answer that Chris did, the answer that you gave first does not exist on the list. Shuck was not an answer.
Which I'm like, what are these people doing? Like back in my day, I shuck corn.
Yeah.
My mom would send me to the back deck and shuck the corn because you don't want the fucking hairs all over the ground. Bullshit. Is peel there? Because like that's...
It's not.
What?
Peel? Okay. Well, we'll get there. We'll get there. Yeah. We got other answers to get through first.
So to review the questions.
Bad about the corn.
Me too.
Name an occupation a bad driver should avoid. You said taxi driver. Chris also said taxi driver. So then you said delivery. And that is the fourth answer with 6 points.
Okay. What were the other ones?
Number one answer was truck driver. Long haul truck driver.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Okay. In my mind, I was thinking truck driver, but delivery could be like pizza, you know?
Well, delivery was its own separate answer. So when you said delivery.
Yeah.
Number two was bus driver.
That makes sense.
Number four was delivery driver. Number three was taxi driver. Number five was auto racing. Six, ambulance driver. Seven, chauffeur. And eight, heavy equipment operator. Next question was name something specific that people make reservations for. You said dinner. Chris also guessed dinner. That is the number one answer. So then you said movies. And movies is not on the list. So you get a zero.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. You number show two, the movies.
Number two is hotels. Number three is airplanes. Number four is tours.
All that
five
stuff.
Is vacation. Six is car rental. Seven is cruise. Next one was name something the woman never forgets about her fiance's marriage proposal. Chris said the place. You also said the place. So that was number two with a score of 31. Number one was the way he asked her with 43. And number three was size of the ring with 22.
Okay, I'll take it.
There are only three answers to that question. That's it. Name something that a burglar checks to see if a family is out of town. You said lights off. Chris guessed no car in the driveway, which is third. Lights off number two with 27 points. Mail number one with 33 points. And newspapers piling up with five.
Guess we wouldn't make good burglars, Chris.
No, I guess not.
Name something people do to corn. You both said shuck.
Aw, shucks.
But then, Ober, you came back and you guessed eat. Eat comes in at number two with 26 points.
What are these people doing with corn?
Pop, I guess. I don't know.
Number one is pop.
Pop.
Number three is boil. Number four is cook. And number five is butter.
Cook and boil.
Right? Pop is also a way to cook it.
Also true.
If you think about it.
Also true.
So, in total, you did
okay.
not beat
the... I think we did okay.
We didn't get 200, but we got close, I think.
New high score.
Oh, yeah.
So, in total, 189.
Oh, man. That was...
All right. We'll get there someday.
Scored 81.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, great minds think alike. I'll say that much.
Yeah, I know.
A lot of buzzers on that.
Yeah. Especially with Shuck. I was like, oh, my God. Like,
yeah. At least... Right?
I felt semi-vindicated because I was like, how is Shuck not on the list? Like, what is this?
Yeah.
But if they would have asked...
Do they have a different word in other parts of the country for shucking?
That's what I was like. Do they call it like peeling or shellacking or something? Like, I don't know. But like,
right.
Wasn't even on the list.
That's bonkers. But anyways, I guess pop makes sense. And then as soon as I was done, I was like, I probably should have said eat, you know, so...
Right, yeah. Well, that was fun. You know, we'll get to 200 someday, but until then... We'll just sit back with our moose juice and our yuzu. And
in case anybody goes back to correct me, if anybody ever finds this list, technically speaking, number two on the list was east, what they do with corn, and I'm assuming it's a typo and it's supposed to be eat. And I didn't feel like doing a bubble boy from Seinfeld thing here.
It says moops. It says moops.
I'm sorry, it's the moops. So I counted that as eat.
Funny. I was going to make a boops reference. I was like, nobody's going to get that. So I'm glad that you did before me.
I love that show. I could watch Seinfeld forever.
You should make it a handle one day.
Sorry, but the answer is the moops.
Well, speaking of handles, I guess it's that time.
Wait, hang on. Chris, have you never watched Seinfeld?
No, I've not. I've seen bits and pieces. I didn't find him.
Chris can tell you which one is Elaine, which one's Kramer.
yes.
And
yes.
Maybe George.
50-50 on George and Jerry.
Yeah, right. Whatever one. Well, I can tell you which one was in Jurrassic Park and then the one that was not.
That's neither one of George or Jerry.
I don't know. Back in the day, I didn't find it like overly funny. So that's why I didn't really watch it. Maybe in my old age, maybe I'd have a new appreciation for it. But there's also, I mean... So many things for me to watch, you know, always, you know, up and coming, new
age. Yeah, you're always watching things.
New age.
If we know anything about you, you are constantly watching TV shows.
I'm just always like, you know, oh man, day it releases, gotta watch it, so.
So your time's almost, you're almost ready for Seinfeld.
Yeah, when they reboot it, yeah.
Oh, there we go.
I'll be there. Yeah.
Chris is more of a Frasier kind of sitcom guy.
I do love Frasier. Is that the division? Is it like Frasier versus Seinfeld? Is that like, was that the battle lines back in the day?
No, it's Friends or Seinfeld.
Yeah, it's Friends and Seinfeld.
Oh, I didn't watch either one of them. There you go. Oh, and the Frasier guys.
A lot of people watch both, just FYI.
Frasier's the New York Mets of sitcoms.
I also think it came out after Seinfeld and Friends both ended.
Frasier?
Yeah. Like, it didn't immediately spin off, right?
Of Cheers?
I mean, Frasier had, like, 11 seasons, so I think it was pretty... It was, I mean...
93 to 04.
Yes, it's pretty concurrent with Seinfeld.
And it was on NBC, which probably means they were probably on at the same...
They're probably, like, back-to-back or whatever.
Yeah, it probably went, like, Seinfeld into Frasier.
We'll never know. The technology is lost. You have to go to the archives tab of Just Watch to figure out.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm kicking it over to the Frosty Mug of Wisdom. Filled up with hacks, advice, fast money answers. Who knows what we got in there? Jordan, take it away.
Test your handle. Test your handle. Test your handle. Test.
Mug of Wisdom! Drink. Mug of Wisdom!
All right, thank you, Jordan. Tud, honk, 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 honk. Hotly contested, but you win fair and square. You beat Chris, I mean... You can't get any more fairer and squarer than that.
That is true.
From the same four pack of seltzers, you know, there's no variation there.
It's weird how from the same four pack, Chris and I described them separately, like very differently.
Yeah, just speaks to differences in your palate and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, and it's very rare when we get to review the same thing at the same time, especially from the same four pack.
Yeah, pretty cool though.
So
also a big score update. Todd's at 49.
Damn.
So we're getting there.
So if I reach 50 before you guys, do I get to like take all your points? All your points belong to me.
Mm-hmm. That's that'll be the end of the leaderboard. It's we've actually been playing a game. First to 50 wins. So.
End of the podcast.
Yep. So start chilling your bottle of champagne now. Yep. So that way, when you do hit that 50, it's ready, and you'll be able to celebrate.
Perfect. Well, yes. Thank you for making me man of the people, Tud, or semicolon Tud. You know, this week. It's been an honor, a pleasure.
Thank the goose.
We always thank Goose, the band. My handle this week is, I'm kind of tempted to make it Seinfeld, so Chris has to go watch Seinfeld.
That's how it works. Whoever wins the point, the other two have to do the handle.
Yeah. But you know what?
My handle this week is flying to Montana.
we talked so much about Seinfeld this week that it would be kind of weird to make it the handle. So I will go one step removed, and I'll say Curb Your Enthusiasm. Chris, you should go watch that. I think you'll like it. Maybe more. So some people who don't like Seinfeld like Curb better, and some people who like Curb don't like Seinfeld. Essentially, Curb Your Enthusiasm is Seinfeld just if the main character was George. Larry David, the creator of Seinfeld with Jerry Seinfeld, then went on to create Curb Your Enthusiasm, his own television show on HBO. It aired for 16 seasons. It just ended this past year. And Larry is the main character of Curb Your Enthusiasm. He plays himself. He's got all his, like, you know, Hollywood friends in there. So Ted Danson's a reoccurring character. Jeff Goldblum plays his manager, so he doesn't play himself, but he plays Larry's manager. What's the comedian's name? Richard Lewis is a reoccurring character up until his death. Cheryl Hines, who's in real life is Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s wife, plays Larry, Cheryl David in the show. It's a great show. J.B. Smoove enters in around season 6, makes it even more funny. A great show. Chris, if you don't like Seinfeld, I would recommend giving Curb Your Enthusiasm a shot. It's still a half-hour sitcom. It's a little bit more dirty. Obviously, there's swearing and stuff. It's on HBO. They can say whatever the hell they want. It's worth your time, though. It's basically if George Costanza was the main character of Seinfeld and was successful.
Now, if you had one episode to recommend to somebody to start at, what would you say? Because I feel like it took a couple of seasons maybe to find its footing, and the first season came out 24 years ago, so it's a little dated. Do you have like one, you're like, I love this episode, I think anybody could go and enjoy it?
I mean, I'm partial to what's the name of the episode? Ober, you're a Curb expert, right? You've watched all the Curb.
I have, yeah.
It's the women's panties episode.
My name is Larry David, and I like to wear women's panties.
Yes, correct.
Just type that into Google, and you'll find the episode number.
Yeah.
We'll I don't know. I'll probably like a specific YouTube video from that episode or something. But I would say the Palestinian chicken episode was a good one.
Great.
A good one to start at.
The name of the episode with the women's panties is Officer Krupke.
Yeah.
Who are you? Larry David. And what do you happen to enjoy? I happen to enjoy wearing women's panties.
did you just finish your first watch through of it?
I just finished the whole, I've been watching it for years, but obviously it just finished up this past year. And I don't think we've ever talked about it before, so it's a good one.
Yeah, I didn't know you were a fan.
And especially if Chris is not a fan, for so many people I know didn't like Seinfeld, they love Curb. And then once they watch Curb, they're like, now I like Seinfeld. So it's very entertaining, Chris. You would get a kick out of it.
Yeah, I'm sure I would. I've heard recommendations for it before. Like I said, so many new things, just hard to keep up, you know? So
also, another episode to watch is the episode that Larry brings a prostitute to the baseball game so he can use the HOV lane.
That's pretty good.
It's a good one. Okay, who's going next, Todd?
I'll let Chris go. He did come in second, so.
Yeah, that means I should go last.
You did come in second of two, so.
All right, so, okay. I'll put over, so I recently watched a new old movie. So my kids recently have gotten into Jurrassic World, like hardcore, like they love dinosaurs now. Unfortunately, these dang kids, they love Jurrassic World. So, you know, I've seen Jurassic World, but I had not seen the second one, Fallen Kingdom, or Dominion, the third one. Well, Fallen Kingdom was available on Amazon Prime. I think it literally just went away the other day. So we sat down and we watched it, and it was interesting. It was an interesting take on the Jurassic World series. I don't know if you guys have watched any of these since, maybe you saw the, have you seen any of the Jurassic Worlds?
The first, is this the one, first one? Yeah. Is this the one with Chris Pratt?
They all have Chris Pratt, right?
The Jurassic Worlds have Chris Pratt, yes.
I saw the one with Jimmy Buffett in it, whatever one that one is.
That's the first one. So this is the second movie, and it's entertaining. You know, they have big scary dinosaur that they built, even though they built a dinosaur and it was bad in the first, spoilers. And my kids,
what the hell, Chris?
My kids freaking love it, right? So now ultimately, I want to put over the original Jurassic Park. Because it's so far superior to these Jurassic World movies, and I can't get my damn kids to watch them with me.
Why not?
Because we tried the other day, and you know, okay. Jurassic World starts so, like, you're like immediately, boom, dinosaurs, right? Like they're right there. Whereas like
right from the beginning,
and that's what hooked them. Plus, like they know the Indominus Rex from Jurassic World, like the made-up dinosaur that they made, and they know about the Indoraptor, which is the one from Fallen Kingdom. Like, so they know about these. They've heard about them or seen them on whatever. So we tried to watch Jurassic Park the other day, but Jurassic Park's kind of a slow build until you start seeing, well, you get the Velociraptor right at the beginning, and then it's a slow build until you get to, like, the really good, you know, stuff. And then CJ, we're sitting there watching it, and it like pans over a field. He's like, "Why is it all blurry?" And I was like, "Kid, this is 1983. Like, this is 35 years old." And then he got really scared at the T-Rex part, which he never got scared during Jurassic World. So I'm like, "See, this is
more
true.
Intense. This is more, it's real."
Yeah. So I have enjoyed the Jurassic Worlds that I've seen, but none of them hold a candle to Jurassic Park. So I just want to, you know, if you haven't seen the Jurassic Worlds, I would listen. Don't expect a ton. The first one's the best one so far. I haven't seen the third one yet. But just watch Jurassic Park over and over again. It's way better. So,
so just so I know what to put in the description.
I don't know. Just link them all.
What's your handle?
I don't know.
What's
dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs. Yeah. Just put,
it sounds like you really want to make Jurassic Park your handle.
Is dinosaurs.com a thing? Oh boy, this is going to be scary. It's for sale right now. You can buy it for $400,000 USD.
Not bad.
Yeah, not bad. Someone buy us dinosaurs.com for the podcast.
We'll put it to good use, I swear. We'll start a new podcast where we just critique the new Jurassic World movies.
Put in Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom, because that's the movie that sparked this. And then in quotations, put the original Jurassic Park movie.
Okay, I can do that.
That's what we need. Yeah, that's what we need.
So did CJ make it through the whole movie?
No, he said he hated it. He said he didn't want to watch it. So got to try again in a few years. The T-Rex part.
Maybe you got to reverse psychology him and be like, after he goes to bed, you put it on, maybe a little louder than you normally watching TV. We can't let CJ watch this. It's too scary. He can't handle it.
No, I mean, the T-Rex part, he was like petrified of. And I was like, yeah, because it's real dinosaurs, not this fake crap you watch on Jurassic World.
Right?
Oh, man. But, there you go. This is my bushwhacked handle.
Okay. I'll accept it. I do have a question, though. It was occurring to me when we were holding our flashlights up to our beer. Why is it the T-Rex scale when T-Rexes just sense motion and not, like, that's the whole thing in Jurassic Park is, like, they only see you when you move.
You know, it's kind of a hypothetical situation, Obert. Like, we don't believe that we're actually going to ever be inside beer with a T-Rex trying to find us.
Okay. All right. I was hoping you'd have a funnier answer than that. But
it sounds better than raptor, you know, raptor scale.
Well, yeah, it was started off as the deer in the headlights test.
Yeah, right? But then we then it was you
the original test.
Yeah, and you hated it. And then when we started bringing dinosaurs,
I still hate it. But
when we started bringing in dinosaurs, you seemed to like it better. So it stuck as the T-Rex test.
Okay, all right, fair enough.
And it's the kind of the question is: could you move in the beer without the T-Rex seeing you?
Right. Okay. All right. I'll keep that in mind next time I'm holding up a flashlight to my beer. Chris, may I take this Frosty mug from you?
Please do.
Okay. My handle this week, I think more for Tud than for Chris, because I feel like, Chris, you're not a big cell phone game enjoyer, but I could be wrong. This is iOS and Android. I think it just celebrated its 10th anniversary. It has everything I like in a cell phone game. No ads, no cheap gimmicks, no gambling mechanics. It's called Shattered Pixel Dungeon, I believe. It's, I think, $5 or $10 on the App Store. But there's a free trial, which is also good. And you can basically play through the game with one character, see if you like it. Yeah, it's a hard game. I have yet to beat it. It's a roguelike game. You know, maybe you're talking about Diablo last week inspired me to bring it up this week, which is, you know, you start on level one with a new character. You know, there's a rogue, a mage, a fighter, you know, all the classics. And as you descend through the dungeon, you go through different biomes. Okay, first it's, you know, the sewers, and then it's the jail. And then, you know, you go more and more hardcore from there, and you get spells, you get better equipment. There's curses, there's potions, there's, you know, alchemy. For it being just a little touch the screen and your guy attacks or your guy moves there, it's a lot of fun. The other thing I like about it is time only moves when you take an action. It's turn-based, so it's not you have to be glued to your phone. You can have it on while you're doing something else. Good pooping game, you know.
Always good to have a pooping game.
Yeah, I think you would both enjoy it. It's like I said, it's hard, and the more you play it, the more you the better you get at it. You have to kind of learn the mechanics, learn, you know, how the game works, how to beat it as you go. So I think you both like it. Check it out. Again, link in the show notes.
And with that, we'll thank the people who provided today's beers. We will thank New Hokkaido for their Yuzu Ona, and I'm also going to thank Obert for sending it to me.
I would also like to thank Obert and New Hokkaido for the Yuzu Ona craft seltzer.
You're welcome, guys. I'll thank Creekside for their Moose Juice hard seltzer.
Please make sure you head over to social media and follow us everywhere at DAWF Podcast. Also, make sure you hashtag follow the email at DAWFpodcast@gmail.com. You can head over to Discord and join the live conversation over there. That's just a link in the show notes. Go down there, click it, download the app, join there. If you want to talk with other fans of the podcast, you can also head over to Patreon, and for as little as $1 a month, 25 cents a week, 20 cents a week on some months, you get some bonus episodes called The Pregame over there. It's 25 to 30 minute bite-sized episodes. Just go check that out. It's also a way to monetarily help support the podcast. Like I said, for as little as $1 a month, or for, you know, $10 million a month, if you really want to be generous, you know, we would appreciate it. But, you know, it allows us to do fun things, and, you know, $10 million is really what we're shooting for, so make sure you go do that. And then finally, head over to your whatever podcast app you're listening to, you know, right now on, so Stitcher, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, SiriusXM, I think now carries podcasts, YouTube, wherever. Subscribe, give us a rating. It helps. The more ratings we get, the more we move up in the charts, the more people find us. And with that, my name's Dud.
My name's Chris.
And I'm Obert. And remember, if you're drinking alone, do it with friends.
I like this song.
Good. I wish I liked mine. Not enough moose or too much moose. I can't decide which one.
It did look suspiciously like moose juice.
Have you seen... We're talking about moose milk, a different kind of moose milk, a few episodes ago without you. But I wonder how you know what that looks like, Todd.